Lord Jesus, I just thank you this morning for your grace in our lives. Thank you, Lord, that you have come. Thank you that you were born of a virgin, Lord, and that you lived a life that was sinless and that you died on the cross for us. Thank you for your redemption in our lives, Lord. I just pray that you'd bless this time, bless our community with one another. And Lord, I just pray that you would feel free to work in our midst. This is your church this morning, Lord Jesus. We give it over to you. Thank you, Lord, in your name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated for a moment if you would like. I have these Connect cards. If you are here this morning and you've never filled one of these out for me, and you would be willing to do so, I'd encourage you to, so that you might, so I may know that you were here this morning and have the information for you. Also, there's a spot on the back for a prayer request. Also, you'll notice in your bulletin, we are accepting members. If you're not a member here, we won't hold you against you if you're not, but if you'd like to take that step and become a member, there's a spot here for you to say, I would like to become a member. And so if you'd fill this out, even if I have all of your information, fill that out and just mark that box there, then you and I can talk about the process. It's not a hard one. Don't be intimidated. It's not a hard one, but we would like to go through that process with you and accept you as members at the annual business meeting in February. And so it does take a little bit of time, and with the holidays, we probably won't do much with it in December. But we want to know if that is you. If you'd like to become a member, you just fill this out, put it on. Or if you don't want to do that, just say, hey, Pastor, I'd like to join the church. And I'll fill one out for you. So you do that. Also, there is an insert in your bulletin. We're going to have our Canyon Christmas celebration here next Sunday night, 6 o'clock. Canyon Bible Fellowship will be with us. Mahama Community Church will be with us. We're going to have a great time celebrating the season. And that'll be a great time. And may I take the opportunity to thank everyone that came yesterday and decorated. The church looks fantastic. If you haven't been in the Family Center, you ought to go in there. It looks great. The foyer looks great. The room upstairs looks fantastic. The kids went up and celebrate and decorated their room. And even the youth room.
We have a Christmas tree.
Woohoo! And so thank you so much for taking the time to come and to decorate, and I truly, truly appreciate it. And why don't you stand? Let's sing.
All right. All right.
Good God Almighty, I hope you find me. Bring your name.
Yeah.
looking at that baby in the manger and thinking, God sent his son. And even when he sent that precious baby, he knew that he would one day die for us.
Let's go. Thank you. I sing praise to the King of
Worship him. We praise your name, Lord. We bow before you, Lord Jesus. We proclaim you as the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. You're the King of all creation. You are the Ancient of Days. You're the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. We worship you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We glorify you. You are worthy to be praised this morning. Thank you. To you be all glory and power and honor. For Lord Jesus, with your blood you redeemed mankind. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord. you're here and you have the interpretation to this message in tongues, don't hesitate. Be obedient. It's for the edification of the body. Blessed Lord Jesus.
I will never cease to show you myself and my power. I will never cease. There's nothing you can do that will take away me giving you the power to overcome in this world. There is no fear. There is no condemnation in me.
Yes.
The mistakes that have happened in your life were things I knew about when I passed, when I died on the cross for you. Take the power. Take the power.
Yes.
There is so much power left in me. There is so much power left in me. I will never, ever cease with the power that I have in me to give to you. It is yours. Take it. Use it. Defeat the enemy with it. I have given you the power. Defeat the enemy with it. Use it against you. Use it against the enemy with your children. Use it against the enemy with the world. Use it against the enemy with sickness, with darkness, with things, relationships. The enemy has no power. Stop giving him power.
Yes.
He has no power. I have the power.
You
I
have
want
the power.
You to know.
Praise him. Let's just praise.
Praise.
Encouragement from you. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that is alive and working in our midst. Lord, I pray that we would be ever sensitive to you and your workings toward us. I thank you for your healing. Lord, I thank you for your forgiveness in our lives, for redeeming us by your blood, for your encouragement and your comfort. Thank you, Lord, that you have loved us, even in those times when we are unlovable. Lord Jesus, I just pray that you would be with those who are in need of your touch. I pray for Heidi this morning and Lowell, that you would minister to them and heal their bodies and give strength and comfort and encouragement to their families. I pray for Joelle this morning that you would heal her body and you would draw her close to you. Lord Jesus, I pray for David as he goes to the doctor Tuesday. I pray for a good report. Give the doctors wisdom. I pray for the Clevenger family this morning, Lord, that you would touch them. I pray that you'd cause a quick healing and recovery from this surgery that she's had, that mom has had. And Lord Jesus, I just pray for all those who are here who have needs. I pray that you would minister, that you would be gracious and merciful and compassionate. We worship you, Lord. We praise your name. I pray for the rest of this service that you would be glorified in all that occurs. We thank you, Lord, in your precious name. Amen. Amen. Would you like to shake hands with a few? Bless them in the name of the Lord this morning. Say Merry Christmas. It's a few days early, but I don't think they'd mind. Children, you may be dismissed to go to children's church.
Six.
Yes, more and more I realize I'm not going to be here forever. We like to think that this is permanent. No.
Oh, you only do, right?
Good morning, Gary.
What's the offering?
Just gonna play some music.
Okay. If you could begin to make your way back to your seats.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask the ushers if they could come and help me with the offering this morning. Bruce, would you bless this offering, please?
Thank you, Father God, for your many blessings that you just poured out upon us. Lord, I just thank you for this body that you've given us to worship in. And Lord, I just thank you that as we lift our voices to you, that it's pleasing to you. And as we bring our offerings to you, Lord, it's pleasing to you. Lord, I just pray that you would just pour out your blessing and your spirit on the rest of the service in Jesus'
name. Amen. 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 If you'd like to go to Isaiah chapter 7, one of the classic prophecies of the birth of Christ, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, Isaiah speaks of and prophesies concerning the life of Christ more than any other book or other prophet in Scripture. In Isaiah chapter 7, in verse 14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. Lord Jesus, I just thank you for this opportunity to look into your word, and I pray that you would be glorified, that you would be lifted up. Thank you, Lord, that you were willing to leave the splendor of heaven to be born a babe, that you took on human flesh, that you became one of us so that you could comfort and encourage and redeem us from our sin. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that in all these things you are more than enough. Pray that you'd open our hearts, that you would open our ears, that we might hear from you this morning. In your name. Amen. In Isaiah 7:14, we find a great sign, a great name that was given to Jesus, our Savior. He's given a lot of names. In fact, I was asked at a meeting just this last week, what's the greatest name that's been given to Jesus? And several were given. For me, I'd have to say it's Emmanuel. Emmanuel. You know that Emmanuel means God with us. He's God with us. In this, God was proclaiming that Jesus would be born of Mary. He would be born a babe in Bethlehem. He would be one of us. He would fulfill the promises of God, all of the promises of God. By that we mean that as we celebrate, and I really do enjoy all of these decorations, as we celebrate his birth and the wise men and the shepherds and the angels and all of those, we also focus in the distance on his cross, on his suffering, for he was born to die. He was born to die. He was destined for the cross, destined for suffering, for rejection. It was God's will to crush him for our sake. What a great God. What a loving Lord. In Isaiah 53, still Isaiah, still speaking of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, surely he, Jesus, took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Now, I wonder, I don't know, there's very many of you, but perhaps there are some, who you have never felt any sorrow, nor pain, no trial, no tribulation. Anybody here? You never had a bad day. Everything's been gravy all your life. I don't see any hands. Verse 4 gives us hope and encouragement and comfort and strength, because we know that Emmanuel, the one that was born of the Virgin Mary, the one that was born in the manger, the one who was born to live, to die, he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. He's the one who has borne our grief. He's the one who knows how we feel. He's the one that can walk alongside of us, because he's Emmanuel, God with us. He did promise never leave us or forsake us. He's there in the midst of where you are. He's walking through those trials, those tribulations, those desperate circumstances. He knows what we go through. He carried the burden of grief all the way to the cross. Well acquainted. He's well acquainted. There are those that believe that God is in heaven and God is separate and God really doesn't associate or involve himself with us. Need to learn Emmanuel, God with us. There is nothing that we endure or that we can't will endure that Jesus has not faced, experienced, conquered, for he is victorious over all things. We can never have a broken heart that is greater than the broken heart he felt as he hung on the cross and said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Such grief, such loss. We can never feel despair greater than his. We can never feel pain greater than he felt. Our trials are not greater than His. Therefore, look through your tears and gaze into His face. Look on His brow that bore the crown of thorns. Look at His back that was shredded so that your wounds might be healed. Look at His hands and His feet that He endured for you. Your pain is not as great as His. And He says, look at me and be healed. Look at me and be comforted. Jesus Christ wants you to draw close to Him. Has He not said, cast all your cares on Him? Understanding and knowing and accepting that He cares for you. And that He understands what you're going through. I have been in times in my life when I thought, you know what? No one understands what's going on with me. Have you ever said that to yourself?
Yes.
Have you ever gotten into that pity party? Oh, yeah. Well, get out of that pity party, because even if the whole world does not understand, there is one that does.
Yes.
He experienced it all for you. He knows. He understands. And He was willing to be born to die. He came to bear our burdens, to carry our sorrows. And you know what? Today He is still Emmanuel, God with us. He is still Emmanuel and is willing to walk through life's pathways with us. He is still Emmanuel. And you know what? I wouldn't have it any other way.
Amen.
Would you? Do you want to go out in life's pathways without Him? Aren't you thankful that He's willing to go with you? To walk with you? Regardless of the circumstances, Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, is with you. Praise God. Now I want to skip over verse 5 for a minute and go 6. If we can go to verse 6, please. Oh. I drive down the road and see flocks of sheep, don't you? I don't like to think of myself as a sheep. I don't like to think of you as sheep. Bah. But verse 6. They seem like an ornery, stubborn bunch, if you ask me. Not like lazy, not like you. You're not stubborn, you're not ornery. However, this says, we all like sheep have gone astray. How rude is that? But it's truth. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned his own way, and the Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all. You realize that much of grief or pain or sorrow is of our own making. Some of it is not deserved. Some of it is just cast on us. But choices, the choices we make, well, you know, they have a consequence. Much of our grief is because we have strayed from Him, or we have strayed from His ways, or we were never in His way in the first place. Much of our distress is that we are living a life that is out of kilter, a life that is upside down, because we're not living in fellowship or communion with Jesus Christ, wandering from Him. What, you watch National Geographic or animal shows, and the sheep that wanders from the shepherd, don't you kind of think to yourself, oh no, because usually in those shows there's a lion or a wolf or something that is hungry and wants lunch. It's dangerous for a sheep to wander from the shepherd. There's grief that is had from wandering from the shepherd. You do realize he is the great shepherd. Sin causes us to wander and to stray like sheep. Now, why would we do such a thing? Why would we separate ourselves from a loving and caring shepherd who watches over us and cares for us? In the same way, sin causes us to wander into a far land, like the prodigal son. Had everything he needed, but yet, out of his stubbornness and rebellion, well, I'm going to go away from my father. I'm going to wander away. I'm going to do my own thing. We want our own way because, well, sometimes the grass looks greener over there. I've driven by fields of cows, and the grass on their side of the fence is every bit as green as the grass on the outside of the fence, but they have their snout stuck through that fence, and they're trying with all they have to get that blade of grass right over there. We all, like sheep, have gone astray because we want our own way. You know, but more than anything, because we fail to find contentment with our Savior, with our Lord, with our Shepherd. I look at this world and I see anger and rage and depression and violence and sin abounds. But there is a Savior. There are some who try to find contentment or fulfillment through pleasure or greed or godlessness. But you know what? The only source of peace is Jesus Christ. The only source of contentment is when we are in a relationship with Jesus Christ. So look at this. We all, like sheep, have gone astray, and each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So as we stray from him, we wander into sin. So who should bear the consequence of that sin? Weren't we the ones that strayed? Weren't we the ones who sinned? Aren't we the ones who deserve the punishment? But look at this. It lays it out right there. But the Lord has laid on him. That doesn't seem right, that we should sin and that the shepherd should get the punishment. That's not right. But that's exactly what happened. We strayed. The shepherd bore the consequence. God laid on him the iniquity of us, the penalty for us straying from God. Now understand this. There's no amount of self-help book that will return you to the peace that you desire in your heart. There's no amount of sensitivity training that will restore your peace. And you know what? There's no amount of diversity training that'll bring our world back to unity. That might not be very popular to say, but that is true. Do you know what will bring unity and peace to this world? It's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, he is the Prince of Peace. And no amount of yoga or meditation or any other technique to avoid a relationship with God is going to bring us the peace we desire. Now, if you want to see something comical, I have, for the sake of stretching, I've done the downward dog. It is, and I'll tell you, it is a comical thing. I make sure all the doors are locked and the windows are drawn, because no one should be subjected to some of those positions. In fact, I say, Jennifer, you might want to leave the room. Because this, I can demonstrate if you'd like. No. That doesn't bring peace. But when I kneel before him and draw myself into relationship and balance with him, that brings peace. Jesus Christ, the shepherd of our souls. True peace only comes as we deal with our sin. As we sang this morning, as we surrender ourselves to him. Wandering sheep, come home. Loneliness in the night, draw close to the one who loves you most, Jesus Christ. All of these things are resolved as we allow Jesus to deal with us, to love us, to forgive us, to accept us. All right, can we go back to verse 5, please? It says, but he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. You understand the stripes, the wounds that I'm speaking of. You do know the punishment that he did receive. He didn't just receive a stern tongue lashing. Surely you know of the lashes he received as they took strips of leather and put metal, pieces of metal and bone and glass attached to the ends, and stripped him and lashed him to a pole so he could not escape, and then brought down those lashes again and again and again. And every time those lashes would land, that whip would land, it would rip the flesh from his back. Until by the time they were done, bone, his ribs, his spine were exposed. Why would he do such a thing? Why would he submit to such a thing? When we read something such as this, it's easy to gloss over. When we see all the bright lights and the baby in the manger and all of those things, it's easy to forget the suffering, the pain. You know the pain he endured for you. You can comprehend the suffering he endured for you. If you have, it's wrapped in lights, but up on the top of this cross is a crown of thorns. They're made of Jerusalem thorns. The thorns are about yay long. They smashed that on his brow, piercing his scalp. If you have never seen Jerusalem thorns, after service, come up, look at those, and know what he endured for your sake. Because he loves you. Not because he had to, but because he loves you. Do you realize he bore these stripes, that he took these wounds for you? Do you realize that he did it because he loves you? Do you understand now how much he loves you? Do you understand now how much he loves you? And even before he was born, he knew that the cross was coming because he was born to die. You know, this is why we ought not use his name lightly. This is why we ought not mock him or even misuse the healing he purchased for us in his suffering, for it is a mighty thing. It's a precious thing. It's a priceless sacrifice he made for us. Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 and 5, Paul says, "But when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, Emmanuel, God with us, born under the law, to redeem those under the law that we might receive the full rights of sons." Jesus died that we might live, that we might be adopted as the children of God. He was born to die so that we who were dead in our sins, we who had wandered away from him, could be redeemed. He was born to die. He suffered for you and I. He died for our salvation, for our healing, for our encouragement, for our comfort. He died so that you and I could have peace. There are times when circumstances or when things that we have done, we understand that John, 1 John 1:9, if anyone sins, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We understand that. It's another issue altogether for us to forgive ourselves and for us to accept what he has done in our lives. To accept it. We're getting ready for communion, and I would like to ask the ushers to prepare. I would encourage you this morning as we partake of the elements, if that's describing you, things have happened, you've confessed your sin, we know that God is faithful and just, God has forgiven you, but at times you don't forgive yourself. You're still living in condemnation of what occurred. Allow the peace and the grace of God to wash over you and accept his healing. He desires for you to live in peace. And that includes peace with yourself. Go ahead and come. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, I would invite you to partake of the elements with us. They're going to pass it. If you've accepted Christ, go ahead and take bread and cup. Do hold it. Do hold it so that we can all partake together. But if you're here and you've accepted him, you're free to partake with us. If you've not accepted Christ, I would encourage you to let it pass. This is for those who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. While they are doing this and Bob is singing, consider what God has done in your life. And if you live with that you're not able to forgive yourself of what God has forgiven you, you allow him to bring that healing to you this morning. Go ahead. Jesus, I thank you this morning that as we confess our sins before you and as we surrender those things to you, that you are faithful and just to remove them, to redeem us, to restore us. Thank you, Lord, that there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That you don't just forgive, Lord, but that you restore. I pray for any who are here this morning who still live in unforgiveness of themselves, of past failures. I pray that you'd heal their souls this morning. Cause them to live in peace. The peace that only you can give. Thank you, Lord, for the mighty work you've done in our lives. Scripture says that on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had blessed it, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Remember me as often as you eat it." Dale, would you bless this bread, please, for us? Amen. Shall we partake of the bread together? Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the body that you allowed to be broken so that we might be whole. Thank you that you allowed your body to be crushed for our sake. Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had blessed it, he said, This is my blood, which is shed for you. Remember me as oft as you drink it. Don Choate, would you bless this cup, please? Amen. Shall we partake of the cup together? We worship you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Would you stand and sing that chorus with us?
Crucified, laid behind a stone,
something as simple as saying, Jesus was born on Christmas Day. We ask that you bless all that we do, all that we are fellowshipping in. Our hugs and our smiles. Just be with us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.